Welcome, Major General Rugen, and thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Jen. Thanks a lot.
Absolutely. Thank you for being here. I'm going to dive right in with a burning question we all have. Where is the Army in preparing to choose a winner for the future long-range assault aircraft or FLRAA competition? Can we expect an announcement soon? You know, September has been the time frame thrown out by in recent months by Army officials. Is that still the case?
Oh, we're in our quiet period, and what I can assure everyone is the Army will do this to the utmost standard, and that utmost standard is being heavily worked on every day.
All right. So once you pick a winner, you know, what's the plan? What can we expect to see from the winners in terms of delivering aircraft along a timeline? Are you still hoping to see, you know, this fielded by 2030? Is there any potential that that timeline could change?
Again, we're operating off of a four-year acceleration that we worked on just a couple of years ago, and the tremendous successes we saw out of the Joint Multi-Role Tech Demonstrator, and then two rounds of significant risk reduction, where Congress, invested heavily in getting those two rounds of risk reduction. We're finishing up that risk reduction now. And again, this effort to prototype, or, you know, fly before we buy, has been very valuable. And then in addition, you know, the aggressive red teaming, so those independent tech readiness assessments that look at the risk, that look at the tech, outside of you know, the FVL team writ large, between me and the PEO aviation, you know, someone external that has been able to point at the risk and say, hey, drive that down to get after your goals. Four-year acceleration, the guys are moving fast. I think what you're going to see mid-decade is flying prototypes. So those test articles will be out mid-decade, and we'll be flying those. And that's really the next thing that that I'm working on.
Okay. Now, obviously, there's been concern over the Army being able to afford and acquire two helicopters at once, both the FLRAA and the FARA aircraft. Sure. And you've made a case for why the Army has to acquire both in order to achieve what is needed operationally against highly capable threats. Sure. Are you getting the support you need from Congress to accomplish this ambitious task?
Yeah, very much so. I think, again, we've led a very transparent program. And, you know, I point back to the inflection point we're at. You know, when you look at the 90s and all the you know, the large major defense programs that Army Aviation was doing, there really wasn't room for that Comanche, or we'd had to choose between, you know, upgrading a lot of Alpha model aircraft across Black Hawk, Chinook, and Apache. And so now, when you look at our fleets are very well modernized across all three models that we fly and fight, and that really gives us the headspace to invest. And you're seeing that those fleet buyouts are happening. You know, you're seeing Army aviation budgets shrinking in the natural progression because they can't afford to. And so what you see is a bit of a pause right now, because we can, those fleets are going to be bought out, and then we can jump to the future with investments in the advanced rotorcraft that are going to help us fight and win on future battlefields.
Okay. What has to be done to continue to maintain buy-in from the people that control the purse strings as you move forward?
It's analytical rigor, and it's experimentation, and it's demonstration, and it's prototyping. And so we are aggressive in our modeling. We are aggressive in taking those data and flying them out in the Western test ranges, as we've done routinely twice a year since 2019. We get flight actuals on all the things that we're doing across our weapon systems and sensors and all the packages that are going on these aircraft. And then we're pouring that in again to our requirements documents to make sure we're building things that are lethal, that are effective against our pacing and high payoff threats, but also informing that affordability side through, again, flight actuals. And so You'll see our OODA loop run aggressively over the next decade. We don't plan on stopping that. And then you'll see that transparent communication of that data back to the decision makers, to inform risk, risk to mission, risk to force, and also cost risk. And again, we're providing that analytical rigor. And then the last thing I would say, and we've just been through, another red team event, but we're not afraid to hire folks outside of our formations, outside the aviation enterprise, to come in and give us a good hard look at what we're doing to make sure we're not just talking in our own echo chamber. So we've just finished up another red team on FARA in the FARA ecosystem, and that's flowed into a completion of an AROC. And so again, not afraid of that transparency.
Okay. What is your assessment as to how well Future Vertical Lift is competing within the Army modernization portfolio?
It's competing very well. And again, it goes back to what I just spoke to, is that analytical rigor and that data and the actuals. I think the prototyping has been phenomenally well received. And I go back to, FARA. We down selected to two vendors in March of 2020, which also was the kickoff of our pandemic that we've all worked our way through. But during that time period, another two design iterations from our performers. So a total of three design iterations. Those ITEP engines coming and getting through the first inch to test. And so I think as we do what we say we're going to do, that resonates very well in the Pentagon, at OSD, and in the Army staff.
Okay. Update us a little more on the FARA program. You mentioned that you recently went through another AROC. If you could talk a little bit about, if you can, the outcome of that, what came of that, and where the companies are in building their aircraft that you're hoping to see fly.
Yeah, so I think I'll take you back a little farther in history. In April 2019, we got our first appropriated dollar for FARA. And so in about 3.5 years, by my math, we got two prototypes that are about 90% complete. During that time, we also made a very strategic decision in the Army to pursue a developmental engine along with a developmental aircraft, because again, we felt that the ITEP technologies with, those in excess of 40% part reduction, the specific fuel consumption or gas mileage bump of 12 to 15%, and the time on wing was something that we wanted to follow through on. What it also did is it gives us, one engine for our FARA, Blackhawk, and Apache. And so plenty of obstacles within the pandemic and supply chain to get through that. But happy to report out, again, the prototypes are about 90% built. ITEP finished up its first engine to test here in June. Some runtime in excess of what was programmed. They're tearing down that engine now, analyzing what's going on with the engine. And then GE will deliver two engines to the performers this November, which again allows us to fly next year. As I look at it, again, the prototypes are about 90% complete and the engine is out, and with the pandemic, very proud of the team and all the adversity that they've fought through. With those three designs, it was a natural time to look at our attributes. So we haven't set requirements yet for FARA. We're in the attribute space because we are prototyping, and the prototyping will inform our requirements, our final requirements. And again, that gets into what will be effective in our pacing theaters against our pacing threats, but also what will be affordable for our budget. And we will keep budget in mind. So again, very proud of the program and very proud of the efforts, and we're in a good space.